Hello and welcome to this DevOps course. We're going to go through in this presentation looking at the very basics of mastering the Linux command line. We're at the login screen of an Ubuntu 24.04 system and we can log in as our lab admin user. So we can go through and put in our password, so PASSW0RD and exclamation mark. And the P is a capital P. Now, on my system, I'm using a Mac OS keyboard. It doesn't seem to work with the English keyboard that we have in Ubuntu. So I'm just going to go through and we can look at how we can make changes to our settings. So if I move through to the gear wheel, I can move through to the keyboard. And you can see this is configured with an English UK keyboard. But if I then go through and add a US source, just English US and add, this will work well with my keyboard. So then as I go through then and close this, I can see from the drop down, I can choose between English UK and English US. To open up our command line, I can go to the bottom left hand corner and the Ubuntu symbol, and this opens up my applications. If I right-click on the terminal, I can pin it to the dash, which is the left-hand taskbar. And then from here, I can open it up easily from the taskbar. I'm going to go through and full screen it. And this is our Linux shell. The default that we will be using will be bash. I can use the echo command to print out a variable. So we look at it with $bash. So if we look at it with $shell, this will contain my default shell. So it's showing that we've got /bin/bash. That's not necessarily my current shell, but it's my default login shell, the shell assigned to me when I log in. At this point, it's worth noting that variables, as most things in Linux, are case sensitive. So if I tried lowercase l's, we don't get anything coming back because it doesn't show the variable. If I want to work out where I am in the file system, I can print pwd to print the working directory. And we can see that we're in /home/labadmin. If I want to move to another directory, let's say, for example, I can go to USR for Unix System Resources. And notice the path separator is a forward slash. And we can go to USR share and then doc. PWD now will go through and show my working directory. But you can also see the directory is included in your prompt. If I use CD by itself, it moves back to my home directory, use cd minus, and I toggle between my previous directory. So cd minus takes you to your previous directory. Really good way of navigating our file system. I'm going to move back into my home directory just to shorten the prompt a little bit. And when we're talking about the prompt is made up of a variable itself. So if I look at echo, $PS1, and don't forget the case sensitivity, this then shows my prompt. Now it looks very complex because it's got a lot of color coding going on, but it also includes the host name of the machine. Now we've got a long host name here, lab admin virtual machine. I can always check that by running the host name command. But to get more information, including information about our operating system, if I run host name CTL, I can hit enter on that and we can see then that this is in fact Ubuntu 24.04 and we can see the virtualization is Hyper-V, it's Microsoft virtualization. Now because our host name is relatively long, what I'm going to do is just clear my screen so I can use the clear command or Control and L. And I can shorten my prompt a little bit by setting the variable, and we're going to have it as export, so it's available to this shell and all commands run from the shell. So exporting a variable is really making it a global or environment variable, so it's available to the shell in which it is set and all commands run from that shell. PS1 equals, and make sure there's no spaces around the equals. And then I can go through and put quotes to make sure everything is passed through to the variable. And we can have, say, slash u for user at, and then normally we'd have slash h for hostname. But we're saying that hostname is relatively long. So we could actually just go through and put a string, let's say Ubuntu. We can specify that we will have our working directory, so slash w, and then slash dollar to give us the dollar prompt. I always put a space after that to separate our prompt from what we're typing. So if I then go through and hit enter on this, you can see now that I've got a shorter prompt. We could put color codes in as well, but for ease, we'll keep it simple like this. Now, what we're going to find, if I log out and log in again, we are going to lose that. I've set it for this shell and only this shell. So we can go through and add this to our login script. What I'm going to do is just echo. If I echo out text, let's say like hello, it's just printed through to the screen. But I can redirect it through to a file. So if I go through and go echo and then send that through to file one, we don't see the information on the screen. It's gone through to file one. And if I cat out file one, we're able to see the word hello went to file one. Now we can use this in a similar way. I can go through then and echo. And because I've got single quotes inside of my prompt, I'm going to use double quotes on the outside. And then I can go through and grab my command and copy this and paste. I can close off my double quotes. And I'm going to redirect it, but I'm going to append. So I'm using two greater than symbols. I'm working in my home directory, but I could specify the path. So tilde forward slash dot bash rc, just to make sure that we are sending to my home directory and the file dot bash rc. In Linux, any file or directory that starts with a dot is a hidden file. So if I hit enter on this, we've sent the information through to the file. But if I run ls here, we don't see the file .bashrc because it's a hidden file. But ls minus a for all, we can see that we include hidden files. And we can see in that second column now the .bashrc file. To show that it's worked, if I go through and have my export again, and let's just up arrow key, and we can set our PS1 to just, let's say, the word Fred followed by a space. So you can see that's my prompt now. I can clear my screen and we can see that we've got the glorious prompt that is just Fred. Now, if I log out and log in again, I'm going to pick up my new prompt, but we can also read in from that file. So source dot bash rc. We're going to read that script into our current environment. And you can see now that we have correctly set our prompt. So we're looking good to go. And we've learned a few things. If I type out the history command, we can go through and see some of the commands that we have run. Some of our basic commands that we could get used to would be things like the date command. And you can see this shows me both the date and the time. What we can do is start formatting it. So if I go through and do a date, so plus percent F, we can see that we get year, month and day. Now, this could be really useful. Because if I wanted to make a copy of a file, so let's say CP for copy, file one, I need to make a backup of it. I can copy it then to file one dot and put a date extension on. So using dollar and parentheses, we can evaluate the command inside of the parentheses. So if I put date plus percent F, we know that that's going to give me year, month and day. So now as I look at my file and do file star, so anything starting with file, we've got file one and file 1.2024-05-06. So it can be a really great way of shortening your commands. We can also use the TTY command. The TTY command is going to show me the terminal that I've connected to. And this is a pseudo terminal, so /dev PTS for pseudo terminal, and it's the first one, 0. That is a file in the file system, so I could then go through and do an ls minus l to get a long listing of /dev/pts/0. To do this in one go, we could do an ls minus l to get a long listing of the output of our TTY command. And we can see now that in the one command, we've been able to get the same listing that we had done through two separate commands. Now the date command can also be very useful. If I go through date minus D, 30 days, and let's just put that in quotes because we're going to have a space inside of it. It's going to show me the date in 30 days time. If we want to look at that, say, 30 days ago, we can go through and see it 30 days ago, but we could choose any time date element. So we could almost have, if we wanted, 30 years ago. So that was 1994, 30 years in the future. We just put then 30 years. If we need a quick look at our calendar, we can go through and look at the cal. And we can see in here that we don't have the calendar installed, but it gives me the idea that we could install it with sudo apt install ncal. I'm going to leave that for the moment. I'm not that interested, but in the course, we will install that. Some of the other commands that we will be looking at throughout the course will, of course, include things like the ls command. And the nice thing about the ls command is if I go through and say, look at the etc directory, we can see all of the files in the etc directory. We can say, well, that's not that particularly nice, is it? And I would accept, so let's clear this. Well, we could go through then and do a long listing, ls minus l, of the etc directory. And we can still see, well, it's still not that interesting. But if I wanted to see, let's say, the most recently edited files, I could go through and do an ls minus l, put in then sort on our timestamp, and reverse sort so the most recently edited files will show last. /etc/, and then look, and the most recently edited files we can see then are listed towards the bottom. Again, I'm going to clear the screen so I can use clear. As we start to continue, well, we're looking at it there by sorting on the timestamp. If I look at sorting on the size, I can use uppercase S. And now the largest files are listed last. But we might not be able to understand the size as it's showing in bytes. So if we clear the screen, up arrow key again, and we can add in the option H for human readable. And we can see then that largest file, mime.types, down the bottom is 74K. So this is giving you a look at some of the basic commands. For help on those commands, let's clear our screen. Generally, we look at man pages. So if I look at man passwd, passwd would be the password command used to set and manage user passwords. And we can see then that it opened up the man or manual page for this. So I could go through, read my help information. But if we look in the top left-hand corner, it's got passwd1. These are man page sections. The first man page that was found was 1. But there is also a password file, a user account database. If I wanted to look at that, I'd have to explicitly go man 5, passwd. So it opens up the help for file formats or what's included in our etc passwd file. So we can see now in our top left-hand corner, it's passwd5. And we can see then that it's giving me the help on the password file and the fields that are included in it. If I hit quit, the man or manual command will give you help on commands that are independent and standalone. But there are many commands like cd and like pwd that are built into the bash command itself. If we want help on those, we can use help cd. So it gives me help on the cd command. Or clear again, and then help pwd. Or even when we're getting into scripting, I can go through and help if, and it will give me the basics of the if statement. So for built-in commands, built into the bash interpreter, we're going to use the help command. For other independent commands, they should come with a man or manual page, so we can use the man command. Man 1 is for user commands, man 5 is for file formats, and man 8 is for administrative commands. So if I wanted to know how to create a user, I could use man 8 user add. But as there is only the one user add command, I could just use man user add. But we can see that's come up in our man page section 8 in our top left hand corner. So we've looked then at an introduction to the bash shell and using the Linux command line. Throughout this 5-day course, we're going to be working at our Linux command line, and we're going to be able to see how we can use this a little bit more. But it's getting you up and running. To elevate our privileges, we've been running our commands as a standard user. But if I clear the screen, if I needed to run something as administrator, I would use sudo before the command. So sudo minus L will list what I'm allowed to do. But you can see we're being prompted for a password. So if I go through now and enter my password, it will then show me what I am allowed to do. And I can run all commands as the root user. However, for our course, we probably don't want to put in the password. So what we can do is change the configuration. But we'll be using Ansible through the course, and we can start looking at that now. To bring down our playbooks, we can use git and clone. Again, we'll be looking at git during our course. HTTPS and going through to github.com. Looking at the Urban Penguin. And DevOps, hit enter on that. We clone the repository. And now if I use Ansible playbook, again, don't worry about Ansible at the moment. We'll see much more on this later. And then moving into the DevOps directory, which will have just been created. And then setup and sudo YAML. We'll actually then apply the configuration. And we can see there that we've added the sudo entry in. And now when I do a sudo minus L to list my privileges, we can see we've got that additional entry where we can run all commands without having to put in a passwd, without having to put in our password. So cloning the repository means that we can pull down some of those configuration files that help us with the course. We've pulled down a little playbook that just sets the information that we need. And that's then configured our sudo privileges.